I lay my burdens at your feet. I'm letting go of all the things I can't control. In my frailty, Lord, I find your strength. I'm depending on a love that won't let go. So I trust you. Trust you, for you are my peace. I lay my burdens at your feet. I'm letting go of all the things I can't control. So I trust you, trust you, yes I trust you, oh you are my, sing this with us, so I trust you. So I trust you, yes I trust you, Father, I trust you, oh you are my peace. Are you in? Come and lay your burdens down. This yoke is easy, there is rest to be found. So I trust you, I trust you, yes I trust you, oh you are my peace. Amen. Welcome to Pulaski Heights United Methodist Church. My name is Trenton Teagarden. I am the Director of Contemporary Music and Worship here. We are so glad that y'all are here to worship with us. We are continuing our sermon series on Rapids. This is actually our last sermon day of the sermon series on Rapids, where we are maneuvering through tough spots on the river. And today we're talking about peace and where we find peace on that river. So now I invite you to stand as you are able and turn to those around you and greet them in the name of Jesus Christ. inside and make it beautiful.
Will you call me child when I
to invite all of our young Christians forward and our children for a message on the steps here with Miss Karen.
Hey everyone, if you have an offering, I've got the basket right there. Put it in. Good morning. Hello, hello. Good morning, everyone. I have a sign with me. If you are a reader, can you help me read this one? Peace, yes, peace. So peace is a beautiful thing, a beautiful blessing that God gives us. What do you think of when you hear peace? What is peace to you? Rest and calm. Ooh, that's a great answer. I love it. Rest and calm. Does that sound good to you? Sound like rest and calm. Good. I want to teach you a way to say peace in another language. Ready? This is how they say peace in the Hebrew language. Shalom. It actually means more than one thing, but peace is one of its meanings. It can mean hello and goodbye or peace. Shalom is how you say peace in Hebrew. So later on today, you are going to hear Henry and Jackson read a scripture about peace, and it's from a book in the Bible called Matthew. And it's the very ending of that book in the Bible. And the very last thing that they say is, and remember, I am with you always until the end of the age. thought that was so important. It was the last thing that Matthew needed to say. I am with you always. So that's pretty calming. Sometimes I get worried, and I need to remind myself of things like that. Maybe I'm anxious about something starting. I'm anxious about, well, I'm a teacher, so the beginning of the school year, sometimes I want everything to go right, so I worry and I think about it. If I can remember peace and say a prayer about it, it helps me to calm down. Maybe you've been scared or worried about something. I'm going to give you a little thing you can do if you ever get scared or worried, because you know God is always with you and can help you. All right, this is the American Sign Language way to say peace. You put one hand on top of the other like this. Interesting. When you do the first part, Corey, can you do the first part? Show the first part again. Like that, and then you flip it. Uh-huh. It almost looks worried, doesn't it, as a hand sign? Let God's peace fill you. So I almost think the American Sign Language is like the lesson for us. So if you get worried or anxious or scared about something, in your hands and remind yourself of the peace of God. God is with you and will always be with you, even if you feel worried. And if you want, you can use this little worry, 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 let it go, because that's how you say peace. Would you say a prayer with me? Heavenly Father, thank you for giving us peace when we're afraid or anxious. Help us to have shalom all the time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks, everyone. The Lord be with you.
Also
with you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, we thank you for calling us by name. In you we live and move and grow. We pray for churches and Christians throughout the world. Remind us of our common foundation in Christ. May we grow together in faith and in love until we attain that unity which is your will. Build us together in Christ. Make us your dwelling place. Send down your Spirit so that we may know Jesus and bear witness to our life and unity in him. May we know the mind of Christ in order to speak God's wisdom everywhere. Strengthen us to work toward peace and reconciliation in church and in our community. Build us together in Christ. Make us your dwelling place. We pray for all churches which are experiencing change, growth or struggle, reconciliation or conflict. Inspire and strengthen them in works of witness and service. Build us together in Christ. Make us your dwelling place. We pray for those who have no home, no land, no food, no work, no medicine, no peace, no shalom. May we recognize and serve Christ in the suffering and in the needy. Build us together in Christ. Make us your dwelling place. We pray for those within our own congregation. Our Christian sympathy is extended to the family of David Collier Tennyson in the death of his stepfather, Calvin Heiss, to the family and friends of Jana Laughlin in her recent death, and Tyler Denton and family in the death of his mother, Maka Parnell. Hospitalized recently are Walter Clark, Kent McKelvey, and Jerry Williams. We rejoice in the birth of Charles William Keating, the child of Christy and Ben Keating. And we rejoice in the baptism of Charlie Graves Coger and Maxwell Steed Coger, children of Sarah and Mike Coger. Loving God, teach us to share with others our time, our energy, our resources, our love. Make us sensitive and responsive to the wounds in the human family and creation. May we be faithful to our calling and live a long life on earth. May we give our whole life to Christ, for we belong to him, and in him are united all things on earth and in heaven. We pray all this in Jesus' name as we pray together the prayer that he taught us, his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Again, welcome. I'm Reverend Betsy Singleton Snyder, one of the pastors here at Pulaski Heights United Methodist Church. Specifically, welcome to New Heights. I want to lift up the opportunities. Make sure that you take a look at those. Those change some week to week, some not every week, but we have some things coming up for the fall that you need to be aware of. One is our Adventures in the Arts program. That's not just for kids. The adults can also take music from Adventures in the Arts here. I happen to have two boys who love to do piano and then one who loves to do guitar. So, and the other one, he stays home and reads, which is great too. So sign up for Adventures in the Arts. You get an arty kid. There's a lot to pick from, so take a look at that list online. Also, newly announced a women's retreat that will be coming up in the fall. You have plenty of time to sign up for it, but it is first come, first serve, so take a look at that. It's also listed in the bulletin. Next week, we will be starting a new sermon series. This whole month, we've been looking at the rapids and maneuvering our spirit journeys in tough waters, and that's what our Vacation Bible School was about. Our kids learned all of these particular scriptures that we have learned. They learned them in a week. We've been learning them over a month to reinforce them. But next month, starting next week, we're going to be talking about the essential prayers. And it's based on, this sermon series is based on Anne Lamott's book, The Essential Prayers. And she tends to think that there are really three main prayers, and they are help, thanks, and wow. So if you think prayer is hard, we're going to kind of break it down for you a little bit. And then the last in that series will be amen. What is amen? What does it mean? Why do we say it? What is the purpose to concluding our prayer? So we hope that you will enjoy that and that it will help you with your prayer life. And you also may want to take a look at Anne Lamott's book of the same name. So we are excited about this new series coming our way in August. Good morning.
As we continue in worship, I invite you to remain seated as we sing this song called Spirit of the Living God. And you may be thinking it's from the hymnal, but this is a different Spirit of the Living God. So we will sing it once through, and then it will repeat itself. So please join in us as we prepare our hearts for Scripture.
Spirit of the living God, we want to know you.
Please stand as you are able for a reading from Matthew 28, 16 through 20. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Jesus came near and spoke to them. I've received all authority in heaven and on earth.
Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything that I've commanded you. Look, I myself will be with you every day until the end of this present.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated.
Let us pray. Gracious God, either through me or in spite of me, speak the good news that we may all hear it, embrace it, and above all, live it to the ends of the earth. In the name of the risen Christ, amen. So let's go to the ends of the earth. Okay, maybe not. And because it's summer, maybe we'll just go to Florida. It's only a 12-hour drive, at least it is for my family, give or take, from Little Rock, Arkansas. Maybe that's a good place to find a little peace, or maybe when you have four kids in the van, it will be anything but peace. So you grab a sack full of books, a really large sack full of books, for the young ones to read, maybe one or two for you, and a bunch of snacks so you won't have to stop too many times, and even some DVDs for the car because you, one of the adults, you are looking for some peace and quiet. You are hoping that within a day's drive, you will find sand on your feet, and the soft and yet powerful and beautiful roar of the ocean waves. You are thinking to yourself, that sounds like peace. That sounds like peace. One of the other aspects of peace you're hoping to find is some respite from the pressures of everyday life, from the pressures of what you read and see in the world every day. Specifically, you are thinking that you will give up reading your news sources. The ones on cable that you hear and the ones on your phone that you scroll through. You are not sure you can handle hearing anymore about the problems of immigration, and the families that could be yours who have been caught up in separations at the border. True, they are uniting some, you realize, but you can't help but continue to wonder about those who aren't united, and you continue to hear the stories. They are unsettling, disturbing, because you love children too. Children. You care about families too. After all, you are a Christ follower. You know that one of the greatest commands is to love neighbor. You are so glad to get a chance again this summer to sit by the waves. You won't have to hear about the confrontations between leaders in other countries and our own leaders, loud exchanges in public meetings, which from where you sit sound like the end of the earth. After all, you live in Arkansas. And yet your faith, your Christian faith, is in some very profound ways defined by these nagging last words of Jesus to his disciples. Actually, they were not words. They were not advice. Those last words of Jesus were a command. I don't know how well Methodists do with commands, but to be blunt this morning, this was a command. And that command specifically told you and me, as it was told to the remaining disciples to whom Jesus appeared, those who follow, all who follow Christ, must go to the ends of the earth. That does not sound peaceful to me. I don't think this command is a peaceful command, or at least I know it doesn't make me feel peaceful inside. In reality, it makes me want to run the other way and look for my beach and my towel and my umbrella and my earbuds for music only. So that's why I was more than happy to endure a forever car ride to get some peace and quiet. I knew I could more easily tune out my fears about Russia hacking our elections. And yet another confrontation with Iran. I could worry less for at least a few days about school children and whether or not all of them are getting the education that each one, no matter economic issues, no matter societal stratification, that each one needs. It would be nice at that beach in Florida not to think about what has recently felt like a constant revelation of bad behavior by men against women in the work world of America. And of news that there are still religious authorities who have gotten away with abuse for way too long. Going to the beach, after all, that's where Jesus found the disciples. Going to the beach would be a nice escape from it all, some peace and quiet. On the beach, I could be a bit like those guards. You remember the guards, the ones that were charged to watch the tomb of that so-called Messiah, that man that some called King of the Jews? Remember those guards? These were the guards at the beginning of our chapter this morning. The boys didn't read that for us. It was ahead, starting in verses 1 on that morning of the resurrection. It's in chapter 28, though, as we begin, and those guards were supposed to be watching that dead body. Well, I mean, it was covered in a tomb. And I'm sure, well, I'd be willing to bet, that they thought it was really easy duty. You know, a peaceful assignment. Oh, sure, you know, they'd been warned that their duty was to make certain that Jesus' disciples didn't come back and try to steal his body so they could say and pass around this misinformation, this fake news that he rose from the dead, because that never happens. From what the guards heard, his followers were now in hiding, so there was no need really anyway to worry about them returning, coming back at all, because those disciples, they were looking for some escape. They needed some peace for themselves after all that horrible last few days of Jesus' life. The guards knew that rock was not moving, and certainly not by some Galilean fisherman. They all lived, you see. They lived in the occupied Roman Empire, which is a dangerous place for any sort of rebel, anybody with different kinds of ideas. Those disciples of Jesus wouldn't come looking for death. After all, death was all around them, and it was certainly now encased behind that rock, that really large boulder. The guards were absolutely certain of one thing: they were going to get some peace and quiet for a few days. I mean, it might have been really like some time off. John Ortberg, a pastor, a Presbyterian pastor, puts it well in his book, No Doubt, No Doubt, K-N-O-W, No Doubt, The Importance of Embracing Uncertainty in Your Life. He describes it by rewriting Pontius Pilate's words about the death of Jesus. And he says this, Pilate, "Well, I guess that's the end of that. I guess we won't hear any more about that movement. I don't know much about this Jesus, but we sure have built him a nice little cage." But that's not what happened. Ortberg adds this observation, "But the thing about Jesus is that you just can't keep him in a cage. He never was a cage kind of guy. The authorities didn't know it, but death wasn't defeat for him. He never was a cage kind of guy." Others have pointed out that the disciples in Matthew's gospel, throughout the entire piece, written for an audience of both Jews and Gentiles, predominantly Jews, they are a work in progress, like most of us. Jesus' own pet name for the disciples in Matthew is Little Faith Ones. Some of us may have heard it translated, "Ye of little faith ones." Thankfully, Jesus also tells them that we only need faith the size of a grain of mustard seed because, well, that's enough. Just that bit, that speck is enough. And so the women believe what the angel says, even when the guards standing near the tomb, their mouths are hanging wide open. And they are the ones, ironically, who appear dead as stone, unable to move, speechless. And we're told that via the women, the disciples believe, or at least they worship some doubt. But that doesn't mean all the doubt is gone, nor does it mean that peace is an escape. Peace is the awareness, even when the world is falling apart or feels like it's coming apart at the seams, that we are not alone. Jesus promised his friends in his last words to them that he would be with them through the teaching and the healing and the feeding and giving ourselves to others. Wherever we go, even when we have some doubts. And we know that because, you know, baby Jesus with his family crossed borders, fleeing a cruel dictator. Jesus crossed borders to heal Gentiles and the oppressed and people possessed by all sorts of afflictions. Jesus was tempted. None of these things involve
peace that means escape. Jesus was rejected by religious folks because he embraced outsiders, addicts, the unclean, the ostracized, and the misunderstood. That is not peace. Or at least peace and quiet. Not only that, Jesus tasted loss. His friends, his followers rejected him and betrayed him in the worst way. They left him completely alone. Jesus didn't escape this life. He entered it. And his peace did not come from avoiding it, but instead through the complete embrace and trust that God was with him, for him, and in him. So he wasn't alone after all. The last words of Jesus, go. It's a command. Go to the ends of the earth for me and take me with you to share. While I was in Florida, thinking I might get some peace and quiet, I did a couple of things I've never done by myself. The first was I went to a tattoo parlor. I'd been thinking about getting a tattoo for a while. I know, it's shocking. I really wanted something that would blend with the very large, noticeable scar on my left arm that was stapled back together after a car wreck. And it looks like it was stapled. I was an English major in college, so I love words and I love literary references. I'm also a pastor and a Christian, obviously, and I like to see references in the gospel in secular art. I could easily be an Orthodox. I love iconography. It's so beautiful. So to think about getting a tattoo, I actually had to go to a tattoo parlor. That meant, of course, that I had to talk to people who are not, frankly, my regular crowd. I certainly know people with tattoos. Maybe some of you have tattoos, but I'm talking about taking in and listening to and committing to be, for me, at the ends of the earth, a tattoo parlor, because I'm a Methodist preacher mom with four little children. Matt, my tattoo artist, asked me about what I wanted. I told him a little bit about myself. I got to tell someone else my story instead of listening to theirs for a while. And I said I thought I might want a reference to a Harry Potter story. You know, some of you know what those are. Those are the series of books about a boy in the wizarding world. And our family loves those stories. We've heard them on CD in the car for hours and hours. My kids could beat you at Harry Potter trivia. I might be able to beat you at Harry Potter trivia. So this guy, Matt, he designed something actually larger and more extravagant than I had planned. I was just going to get a little something. But it was clear to me when he showed back up at the counter to look at my scar and and to give me the template and put it on my arm, that he put his heart into that design and his talent. Let's just say his God-given gifts. So I just decided to have a little faith. I just decided to trust Matt. While I waited, because it takes a while in a tattoo parlor, I met other people and I listened to their stories and why they were there, including there was a father and son from Arkansas up in a small town past Jonesboro, and the son had just turned 18. They're farmers. That's a world different from mine, kind of another end of the earth thing. And so I was curious about their lives and their world, and we have different viewpoints on things, but we talked, and eventually that young man chose a tattoo of Arkansas on his shoulder blade, and in the middle, unsurprisingly in a way, was a duck. Yeah, he likes to hunt. Proud of his state and his life in it. I sat down, this was the hardest part, extended my arm and let Matt begin to work. And as I sat there, I kind of wanted him to talk and let me not think about what was happening. So he told me about growing up in a tiny town in the South. There was one predominant church. I'm not going to name it. I'm not going to say the denomination. That's mean, because Methodists aren't sin-free. You know, when people tell you're a pastor, though, they do tend to tell you their church stories. And usually they're not good. The church that Matt and his family attended faithfully, went to for years and years, eventually refused to officiate his sister's wedding because she got pregnant before she and her boyfriend married. And even though she was, as Matt put it, the most wonderful person he's ever known in his entire life, and a regular in the church's youth and Bible study programs, well, that turned Matt off, because they wouldn't marry her. Matt will never go back to that denomination, and Matt may never go back to church. I'm going to tell you, I commiserated with Matt. And I felt frustrated, and I felt angry that church represented Jesus. That church did not go to the ends of the earth for that young woman and that family. For goodness sakes, who was Jesus' mother? An underage, pregnant peasant. I hoped that because I was sitting in that chair letting Matt tell me about his college days, and yeah, college and grad school animation, very interesting story, and how he decided he wanted to become a tattoo artist. That Matt, maybe in letting me hear that story, felt somebody connected to this Jesus would go further than his own church to share the good news to the ends of the earth. I hope that Matt can feel just a bit in my listening that God loves us so much and wants us never, ever to forget it. That we are beloved. That's what baptism is. It is saying, you are beloved. I made you. I created you. Just as you are loved. And that's a message the whole world needs. Well, whether we're a young farmer in Arkansas, a tattoo artist, or a pastor mom. Peace is not about comfort or quiet, although those things are important, and we probably all need them to commune with the Spirit more deeply and to reflect on our journey at times. You know, I know Jesus himself retreated. He did have those times. Yet, we brothers and sisters are also commanded. Commanded, says Matthew, to take the peace of God wherever we go and share it with those who may need to hear that, yes, God is in tattoo parlors and God is in the Uber car. Yep, I Ubered with a gun fancier mechanic. That's another story. And God is with you and me. Because God loves us. God has already gone to death and back for us. Thanks be to God. Amen.
As we move into our time of offering, I would like to invite our ushers forward for an opportunity to give back to God. And also at this time, I invite you to tear off that perforated Connect card if you haven't already and place it in the baskets as they come around. Let us pray. Generous God, you have blessed us with every good gift. Our hearts overflow with joy and love for the privilege of walking with you and being called your own. Receive these gifts, we pray, as our faithful and grateful response to your gifts of grace and mercy in our lives. Amen. Shown us, oh God, what is good, and you have shown us, oh Lord, what you require. You have heard all our songs, how we long to worship you, yet you told us the offering you desire. Stand as you are able as we join together in song.
Yes.
I want to say one thing about my experience. I will never, ever look at Matthew 28 the same. I will always think about sitting in a tattoo parlor and going to the ends of the earth. Receive this blessing. Go forth and love God and your neighbor in all that you do. Bear witness to the love of Jesus Christ so that those who do not know that love will find in each and every one of us most treasured and generous friends. In the name of Christ, amen.